There are many whites who are trying to solve the problem, but you never see them going under the label of liberals. That white person that you see calling himself a liberal is the most dangerous thing in the entire Western Hemisphere. He's the most deceitful. He's like a fox. And a fox is always more dangerous in the forest than the wolf. You can see the wolf coming. You know what he's up to. But the fox will fool you. He comes at you with his mouth shaped in such a way that even though you see his teeth, you think he's smiling. You take him for a friend.
Man, it's powerful. That is powerful. I remember this being shown, oh God, I don't know how many years ago. I saw this so long ago. And I'm not even going to try to attempt it. It's been years and years and years ago when I saw this from Malcolm X. And his words are so true. They are so, so true. Without a doubt, especially now as you see it, I would say since 2008, easily, actually, as far as being political in the presidential race, especially like I said, when Obama came up. You can go back farther than that from the time from the 60s here, but we'll talk about that in a second though. Anyway, thanks for tuning in here. Check me out here on another video. Man, this is some good stuff here. I got this from Thomas Sowell TV. It's his channel here. Shout out to Thomas Sowell, which I absolutely love Thomas Sowell, man. That's between him and Milton Friedman and God, some of the other ones. Those are probably my two favorites, you know, when it comes to anything that involves political culture, finance, common sense, a lot of this stuff, man, over the years. This guy's so smart, you know. Rest in peace there, Milton Friedman, man. Just a brilliant, brilliant logical economist, man. I mean, it's just, I love listening to him talk when he spits things out and he tells it like it is, you know, and it's so easy to follow. It's just common sense. If, as long as your head is not in the clouds and you don't live in, you know, in a land of delusion, a lot of stuff makes sense what he talks about, so much so. And I take passion to this because when I was in college years ago, as I'm old, at least I'm getting old, that was my major. My major was economics. So even though I didn't get a chance to finish school, the Lord called me to do something else. But that was my thing. And it still is today. I'm still fascinated by economics still to this day. It's one of my kind of nerd passion that I have, I guess. I guess some other nerdy stuff too. I mean, hell, I'm still a gamer. You know, I've been a lifelong gamer, God forever. I still game to this day, you know. That's one of my other little hobbies there. Also, of course, the Second Amendment. That's my wheelhouse, is the Second Amendment. That is my absolute love and passion still. And then along with this too, you know, with politics and economics and stuff like that, man. I love talking about this stuff and love learning more information. And constantly trying to grasp more information about all of this. As much as I've known and I've studied over the years, I'm thirsty for more and more knowledge about this. Okay. But I know for a fact where I am in my journey with this for how many years. And like I said, being a conservative with conservative principles that I was born and raised on, you know, I fell into that thing too when I talked about it on the walkaway video that I did. I put it out there and I believe it's still here. If you go back on my early channel, I think I still have it up here on this one here on my personal channel. Go back in my playlist and look at my videos back early. And my earlier stuff though. And, you know, it's like I said before, man, you know, I think a lot of black folks, man, in my race, my culture here, we are extremely smart, but we are also too damn emotional. And I believe a lot of the way that black folks still to this day, why they constantly vote for Democrats is still baffling to me, but I get it because a lot of it is pure emotion. And Democrats have known how to tap into that years ago, decades ago, they figured that out. I would even say as much as centuries ago, they figured it out. And it just so when it comes to politics, they have it figured out with black folks pretty much, because you figure how you can tug on a black man or black, now especially a black woman, tug on her heartstrings hard enough the right way, you can manipulate them into voting a certain way. And this has been the problem, okay? And what Malcolm X said here was, those words are, like I said, they ring so true nowadays that you just can't avoid it. You can't avoid it. You can't, seriously, if you have your eyes closed, you're not paying attention to this, then at this point, you want to be willfully ignorant, okay, at this point. And I've been saying that for quite some time. You have no excuse not to be informed. So with this here, we're going to look at the rest of this. And because there's more to it. There's more to it, what he talks about here. And as you can tell, the narration from this, we definitely got to take a look at this, man. And tell me what you think.
Many of the prevailing misconceptions of the histories of both blacks and whites in America derive from trying to amalgamate morality and causation so as to make the moral evil of slavery a causal explanation of contemporary negative social phenomena, which have in fact had entirely different historical bases. The touchy pride of white Southerners, ready to explode into deadly violence, has often been explained as being a result of whites being used to unbridled domination over slaves. But the very same attitudes existed among their ancestors in Britain, where slavery did not exist, as those attitudes also existed in those parts of the South where slaves were virtually non-existent, and among people who were in no economic condition to buy slaves. When discussing both blacks and Southern whites, slavery has served as an all-purpose explanation of many social phenomena, ranging from broken families to poor education, lower labor force participation rates, and high rates of crime and violence. Often, evidence has been neither asked for nor given. Not surprisingly, many of these explanations do not stand up under scrutiny. Census data, for example, show that labor force participation rates were higher among non-whites than among whites in 1920 and 1930. No matter what the origin of counterproductive behavior, such behavior must be changed if progress is the goal. On the other hand, if the real agenda is to score points against American society, then blacks can be used as a means to that end. More generally, a pro-black stance by white intellectuals enhances the latter's moral standing and self-esteem, whether or not the particular manifestation of that stance helps or harms blacks on net balance. The chafing restrictions of civilization, which can at times become irksome to people of any color, may be vicariously thrown off by those white intellectuals who cheer on outlandish and even lawless behavior by black hoodlums or entertainers. Blacks, in effect, become the mascots of these intellectuals, symbolizing and acting out the latter's resistance to society, or more accurately, civilization. But while mascots may be indulged, more fundamentally, mascots exist for the sake of those who adopt them, and the actual well-being of the mascot is seldom a high priority. By cheering on counterproductive attitudes, making excuses for self-defeating behavior, and promoting the belief that racism accounts for most of blacks' problems, white intellectuals serve their own psychic, ideological, and political interests. They are the kinds of friends who can do more harm than enemies. A crucial fact about white liberals must be kept in mind. They are not simply in favor of blacks in general. Their solicitude is poured out for blacks as victims, blacks as welfare mothers, criminals, political activists against the larger society, as well as those blacks who serve as general countercultural symbols against the larger society. White liberals have nothing approaching the same interest in blacks as the principal victims of black criminals or as people advancing themselves within the existing framework of American society, including many who have risen within the military. Nor do they get particularly worked up over blacks who build up their own human capital or business capital. None of the many reports of black schools that excel academically seems to arouse any great interest among white liberals. It was not the liberals in Washington, but the Reagan administration, which offered successful black educator Marva Collins an appointment as Secretary of Education.
There you go. Man, it's quick. This one didn't take very long, though, but this is just a nice little small excerpt about this. And it is so true. As I said, Black people are so emotional, especially Black women. And have you not noticed and paid attention over the past, I don't know, say, I would say 20 years, probably less than that, really. I would honestly say a lot of the Black empowerment of women, how it got pushed to the forefront, I should say. I would honestly say it started a lot of it with today's society and technology and everything with social media. As social media started to hit the become the platform as it was starting out new. I would say 2008 with Barack Obama and seeing how it was used as much and the more that social media has grown over the years now to the point of where it is. I would honestly say a lot of the empowerment of Black women have been pushed to the forefront extremely hard from then. Okay. Now, do I say something against it or do I think it's a bad thing? To a degree, I would say yes. I would say a lot of it with, you know, the strong, independent Black woman, of course, that's fine. I get that. But I believe, honestly, the push of that being pushed so hard to the forefront and forgetting about the empowerment of Black men in the nuclear families, that has definitely been kicked to the back burner, especially by LBJ with his Great Society plan there, the war on poverty deal. That's a time when Democrats voted for and passed welfare. They figured it out. Okay. Like I said in my walkaway video, I said before, you know, when after slaves were free, what next? Well, it's still the prejudice and racist South figure, which a lot of Black folks, some left, went north, went west, whatever, they moved and just got away from it once they were free. A lot of Black folks stayed on the plantation because they felt they had no other means of how to take care of themselves. Okay, a lot of it was that. So they weighed it out. The options is, do I go out and put my neck out there in line, or do I stay here and, you know, I'm no longer a slave, but I could still stay here and work on the plantation. Master still feed me, give me a roof over my head, but not treat me so much, whatever. If he's not treated so much a slave and whatever. I mean, that was a lot of the thought process that went on back then. As I said, till this then, with speeded all the way up here through the Klan, Jim Crow, you know what I mean, all the way up till the 60s, up till the Civil Rights move. The Civil Rights was passed. This right here was the start of it right there. Figure it's like, hey, what did they tell you when welfare started? Ladies, the government can do this and this for you and help you out, you know, because, you know, we see you can't get ahead or anything else like that and seeing you having a hard time trying to make it. But the thing is got to get rid of that man in the house. You know, you can't have a father in the house. So what do Black women do? As many have said, Jesse Lee Peterson, he makes me laugh, I swear. Dude is something else, man. He said the same thing, that women got rid of the man in the house who was out there trying to work and make a living and provide for his family. Well, things went wrong and went sour. You know, she get rid of the man and marry the government take over. Then the government just spoon-fed women throughout the years and still doing it till this day, okay? You saw the nuclear family, the Black nuclear family that was at the time before welfare was enacted, it was at, what, 74, 75% of Black households were married. Now, today, it's like just barely above 20%. What happened? And a lot more single Black women. Single Black women, families pumping out. It's just a total mess. But as I've said before, I said in my walkaway video, Democrats are snakes, man. Democrats are snakes. I'm sorry. Democrat politicians are just low down, so low down. And they use emotional tactics such as this, as Malcolm said, white liberal, which is true. I would go a step further is saying even what's even worse than that are Black liberal women or liberal Black women, whichever way you want to put it in order. I would take it even to that level. Myself, personally, I think it's even worse. Because of the movement, because of the black woman empowerment, should women be proud? Absolutely. Should black women should be proud? Absolutely. You know, strong black women. I know there's a lot of strong black women out there that raise strong kids, you know, to become strong, productive adults. I'm not putting a black mark or condemning any black women out there. I'm just saying there is something to be said about that because the numbers don't lie and the numbers show. Are the women out there that are strong and hold a family together and raise productive children, man, to grow up to be productive adults and everything? They raise their kids? Yes. Is it slim? Yes, it's slim. It does happen, without a doubt. But as you see, a lot of these over-emotional kids, men, young boys, okay, we see it. We've seen it for years, years. And nobody just wants to call it out. Nobody wants to call out for what it is, I should say. They don't, you know. You got so-called black leaders, whatever, whoever you want to look up to. I don't see any black leader as a leader of mine at all, period, nor a white leader, either one, okay? I lead and think for myself because I can think for myself, so the only leader that I'm concerned about is the Lord Jesus Christ, and that's it. Outside of that, anybody, another man? No, not even Donald Trump. As much as I like Donald Trump, man, he makes me laugh. And a lot of great things that he did, seriously. And you know what? He's still not my leader, okay? Like I said, I'd look up to no man to lead me in nothing. You know, I lead myself. Only somebody that's concerned about what's best for me is the Lord, number one, and two, me, number two. That's how I look at life, okay? But like I said, though, the empowerment of black women, man, yeah, it's great. But has it gone too far, pushed it too far in certain levels? Absolutely. To the detriment of black men, pushing black men away. So now when it comes here to the today's politics, now black men are waking up, which I'm glad to see. I love to see more and more black men wake up. Wake up and pay attention to who's actually tugging on your heartstrings, put it that way. I love to see more black men wake up and stop being so damn emotional and start thinking with this. Use this first, because this will lie to you. Trust me, it will. You think this won't lie to you? When's the last time when you had your heart broke? That'll tell you right there. Your first crush, how'd that work out? This will lie to you. Believe me, it will. Okay? But this won't. You can see, if you think for yourself, yeah, this ain't gonna lie to you. You see, this will. So stop paying so much attention to this. Start paying more attention up here. That's what I got to say on this video. Hey guys, thanks for listening to me talk a little bit about this though. I love hearing stuff, man, like this and watching different things, man, with Thomas Sowell. Like I said, I love this stuff, man. It's so awesome. It is. Guys, let me know in the comments below, what do you think about this video? Also, let me know in the comments below, do you want to see me go live? Because I have now got things ready to finally go live like I've been wanting to do for years, okay? I can finally do it now without any technical issues like I was having some years ago trying to do it. So I've got that totally fixed, ready to go live. And honestly, live videos, if you guys want to tune in, I'm going to start doing live videos because for me, time-wise, live videos work better for me. Editing takes some time to edit this video. Even editing this video, I have to put time aside to even do it, okay? And that's with my time, with my scheduling, how I work and things, what I have going on, it's difficult to get video or get content out that I want to put out on a regular basis. It's hard to get it to put up for me. Until I can do this full time, guys, I'm going to have to do something different in order to get content out here on this channel, get this channel to grow, guys. You know, share it, like it, helps the algorithm for me. You know how that works. Comment on it, everything else. And let me know. Like I said, I'm going to have to start doing some live stuff here so I get more time because I can sit still, do live, boom, put it up. There you go. Okay. And it helps me out. So let me know. I appreciate you guys tuning in. And like I said, man, guys, just all you do is open your eyes, pay attention, wake up, stop listening to the leftist liberal lies. Seriously, because it's all it is, man. It's so much. And don't get me wrong, man. Republicans lie too, of course. I know. I'm no fool. Like I said, there's a bunch of them I can call out. A bunch of them right now. And I've called them out over the years. And it seems like there's more and more to the list every single year. So anyway, guys, I'll see you on the next one, all right? Be careful and be safe.